This week on Vaticano, come visit with us Rome's Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas, called the Angelicum, and discover the long-standing tradition of Catholic education based on the teachings of the Angelic Doctor. What does it mean to be a pilgrim in the modern world? Meet Patrick Fusi, a courageous young man with a generous heart. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. The smallest nation in the world, Vatican City, has a network of universities across the globe. They're called pontifical or papal universities. Seven of them are located here in Rome, the city built around the seven famous hills. Among these seven, the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas, or the Angelicum, has the longest educational tradition. Its history dates back to the 13th century, to the time when the Dominican order was established. It's actually the first order with a charism for teaching. The current campus was acquired by the university in 1929 in a complex of buildings which made up the former convent of Saints Dominic and Sixtus. It's located in the historical center of Rome. The current rector of the Angelicum, Father Michał Paluch, says the university's focus is to propagate the thought of the angelic doctor of the church, St. Thomas Aquinas.
I think that our greatest ambition is to propose working on the basis of St. Thomas Aquinas, a capacity to put things together, to see them together, following the doctrine of the Catholic Church.
How do you see that students react to that when they come here? Do they know what they're getting into when they arrive
well,
here?
Well, as usual, you can imagine there are some who are who know a lot about St. Thomas. We have some outstanding, really outstanding scholars from different countries working at our university. So they are coming here because of some professor they know, because they had an opportunity to know his book or her book, but there are many students coming here and discovering St. Thomas Aquinas here. Well, don't forget, last year we had our students from 98 different nationalities.
Do you think, in this today where we have this rise of the nuns, young people mostly who are sort of perhaps even raised in the faith, or raised maybe agnostic, but then they decide that they have no religion, that there is no God, this sort of secular mindset sort of takes over and has taken hold, obviously, if there's so many of these people. Nuns is N-O-N-E-S, not
yeah,
N-U-N-S,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
So for these individuals, when you come into contact with St. Thomas Aquinas, can you be a nun? Is it possible for you to think in this university context of someone coming through your institution?
Absolutely. I would say that what is great about St. Thomas, he starts really with our reason, putting things together, not demanding at the beginning to have the faith. It's in the end, his synthesis embraces faith and reason together. They should work together. But there is some access to Aquinas' thought through philosophy. And actually, it's very interesting to see that there are so many philosophers in the United States, but in the whole world, interested today in Aquinas, just because of this possibility to have access to riches, to the whole the whole depth of the Catholic doctrine through philosophy, taking into account our reason.
And they call it Thomistics, right?
Thomas Aquinas worked in the 13th century, so at the moment of our development, when you could try to take into account all the doctrine of the Church from the first millennium, having some distance to it and trying to make a true synthesis, engaging the sciences of this time, and trying, you know, to propose something which takes into account all the most important pieces of our experience, human experience.
When people speak about humanism, they're speaking about Thomas then.
As we know, in the modern world, we developed a kind of humanism, which is presented as the rival of religion, and it is just stupid. I think that what we have to discover, and the Catholic Church has kept this point of view from the beginning for centuries.
And that's what Thomas did, right? He takes the depth of human experience and connects it with God.
Yeah, and what's more, I think he just was able to put the things together, to organize them with such a clarity that it still seems to me be the best school of thinking, just to start.
The Dominican House of Studies, founded by St. Dominic in the 13th century, featured the professor, St. Thomas Aquinas himself. Among the renowned students of the Angelicum since, are St. John Paul II and Archbishop Fulton Sheen. Founded first for Dominican friars, it now welcomes laymen and women together with priests and religious, teaching them theology, canon law, philosophy, and the social sciences.
It's a spiritual journey, coming to Rome, and then an academic journey. I'm full of joy, and it's already, I think I'm already fulfilled being here. The atmosphere, the friendship which I find, the camaraderie, it's very, very warming and welcoming. And so I'm on a good footing, and I'm ready to begin and to forge ahead.
Definitely exciting to be one of the lay people here. I really have never felt my lay status so acutely as I did today, as I'm walking with all the priests, seminarians, nuns. But that's really exciting, and I want it to be not something so extraordinary to have a layperson studying theology, studying at a pontifical university.
Part of the gift of the Angelicum, I think especially to the priests and religious who are here, is that opportunity to continue feeding oneself and to go deeper.
Just beginning this deeper study of theology and biblical studies in order for me to continue my mission to love God and give Him to other people is why this day is so significant. You can only love what you know. And in order for you to love God more and love the faith more and love others more, you have to understand God, the faith, and other people on a more deep level, which is what theology and philosophy give you.
We were able to bring a lot of what we had learned previously from our philosophical studies to the floor so that we can understand the world, how it works, but then also how God interacts and relates to that world.
It's very nice to just get into it, start to study, get all the subjects, and you know, just read, write. I love making notes and just participate in the classes.
So this has been a very, very light day for me. I only had one class. It was Catholic Epistle, and it was just the introduction to it. So it was very, very light. So it might become a bit more tough as we go on, but my first impression is very good.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. The Order of Preachers, known as the Dominican Order, is famed for its intellectual tradition, for producing many leading theologians and philosophers. Its effect, the now traditional white clothes of the popes, also came from the Dominicans. The first Dominican pope, Innocent V, elected in 1276, continued to wear the white habit of the order during his short pontificate. Consequently, it became the common dress for the popes. Today, there are around 5,750 Dominican friars. 4,300 are priests. They're led by the so-called Master of the Order, elected from among their ranks for a 9-year term. Since July the 13th, 2019, the order has been headed by its first master from the Asian continent, Father Gerard Timoner III.
The order has become universal, so that a brother from any part of the world can actually be elected as master of the order. And I think that is also true in the case of the universal church. So what is it that I am bringing to the order? Well, of course, an Asian perspective. But what is that Asian perspective? You know, all the major religious traditions were born in Asia. Hinduism, Buddhism, but also Judaism in that part of Asia that looks towards Europe, as John Paul has said, and also Christianity. And in Asia, you will find 60% of the world's population. And Catholics are a very tiny minority. And how do you live the Christian faith in such a context? If you are a minority, you cannot but be in dialogue with others. That is why in Asia, theologians have developed what they call as the theology of harmony. How to be in dialogue and in harmony with peoples of different faiths. And I think that that sense of the diversity of faiths and perspective is very important for us in this world today. But another thing that I think the church has to learn from Asia is this: we are a minority church, except for the Philippines and East Timor, which are Catholic countries. But in most of the countries, Catholics are a minority. But if you look at the Catholic Church in these countries, they are vibrant.
What are your hopes? What are your goals or priorities over the next years as you head this worldwide order?
It is the chapter that determines the goals or the roadmap, if you will, of the order. And it is my job to be the first among these brothers, to lead the brothers to achieve those goals. So it's not my personal goal. Now, what is now the goal of the order as determined by the previous chapters? We have undergone a certain kind of restructuring of our communities, but more important than that is the internal restructuring, meaning formation. And not just initial formation, but continuing or permanent formation. Another important priority is the promotion of vocation. And it is not just a promotion of new vocations, but it is the promotion of the vocation of all the professed.
You've mentioned your role as master of the order. You are the 88th Master General, is that right?
That's
the
correct.
87th successor of St. Dominic. You're also a successor then to Jordan of Saxony, of Raymond of Capua.
That's correct.
The Peñafort. So from that standpoint, how are you going to serve in continuity with the tradition and the legacy of these extraordinary masters of the past?
A leader is a servant leader because he serves the mission. In this case, I serve the mission of the order. And it is my duty to lead all the brothers to serve with me in that mission of the order. And what is that mission? It is preaching the gospel. And it doesn't change. It doesn't change. And that is the charism of the order, to preach the gospel. And when you preach the gospel, you do not just preach the gospel to the baptized, because the mandate of Christ is to preach to all creatures, to all the world. In other words, this is a charism. This is a mission that will never go out of fashion, because there will always be people who will need to listen
and to learn the gospel.
Well, to that very point, what does the Dominican tradition offer the world and the church today?
Essential to our preaching of the gospel is community, a communal way of preaching the gospel. Because living in community is in itself a preaching of the gospel. And it is part of the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers were of one heart and of one mind, and they proclaimed the gospel.
Father Gerard, thank you so much for your reflections. Thank you so much for your presence, and be assured of our prayers for you and your labors.
Thank you so much.
On behalf of the whole order as well.
Thank you so much.
The UN in Geneva is again raising its voice for the rights of internally displaced persons, and the delegation of the Order of Malta is on the front lines.
As of the end of last year, 41.3 million persons were living in internal displacement because of conflict and violence. Internally displaced persons have had to flee their homes for a number of reasons. For example, armed conflict, violations of human rights, natural disasters, or climate change. It is therefore important that they be assisted wherever they are.
Whilst refugees are more in the public eye, today there are twice as many IDPs as there are refugees. This makes them the largest group of people affected by forced displacement.
In Nigeria, where Boko Haram's violence has led to large-scale displacement, Malteser International is working in the camps for the internally displaced persons by providing clean water, sanitation, hygiene, and similar projects are also being carried out in the South Sudan.
The first secretary of the Holy See delegation at the UN in Geneva, Monsignor Mauro Cionini, is emphasizing that the spiritual aspect is as important as the material assistance.
In this regard, this delegation wishes to recall the role of faith-based organizations, which often are the first providers of assistance to IDPs, including psychological support to overcome the heavy toll of displacement, as well as their spiritual needs.
The Order of Malta carries out its global activities in cooperation with local partners, thus enabling it to make critical and sustainable contributions to all aspects of humanitarian response, including spiritual assistance whenever required.
Being an IDP has consequences. Whilst refugees are protected by international law if they seek safety in another country, IDPs have to rely on their own government for protection from violence and persecution. In many cases, governments are not capable or unwilling to provide such protection. This is why IDPs are among the most vulnerable displaced persons in the world.
Through our humanitarian diplomacy, the Order of Malta advocates the implementation of human rights and international humanitarian law. Our cooperation with the United Nations and its agencies and with local partners enables us to contribute in this way to the international response to internal displacement, which has become a crisis of enormous proportion and affects many, many countries around the world.
In its statement, the Holy See suggested to the UN panel to point out the positive effects new technologies and social media have in preventing and mitigating internal displacement, as well as helping to raise awareness to communities at risk. In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano.
night, I should reach the coast. It's pretty cold here today.
Patrick Fusi, or Pilgrim Patch as he's known, is walking all the way from his front door to Jerusalem. Along the way, he fundraised exactly 2,163 British pounds. That's exactly the number of miles between his hometown in England and Istanbul, Turkey, where he donated the money collected to a charity helping Syrian refugees integrate into Turkish society.
I really do. And what I love about what they're doing is they are treating these Syrian refugees as their own people, as our own people. And I think if everyone did that, the world would be a much, much better place and we would solve a lot of problems. And I see people walking in the opposite direction to me. I mean, this walk is my choice. It's what I want to do, and I have the freedom and the liberty to travel all over the world with my passport. But other people don't have that opportunity. And so it was important for me to choose the right charity, the right cause, and I feel I've done that. And what little role I play, I really hope makes a little bit of a difference.
It was by walking that the idea of this pilgrimage came to his mind.
I did the Santiago de Compostela last year, the Camino Frances, and suddenly I wanted more, as most pilgrims do. They want a little bit more. And I heard about the Via Francigena from some Italian pilgrims that I had met last year, and something just clicked. And I knew I wanted to walk to Rome. And as I started researching, I thought, why not go to Jerusalem? This one.
There were several obstacles for Patch during the journey, but his faith and small gestures of kindness were fundamental to overcoming them.
Starting, taking that first step outside my front door and saying goodbye to my mum. It's a classic, isn't it? But it was really, really difficult to start. And as I said, as I continued, as I gained confidence and trust in what I was doing and trust where my feet were was the right place and where they were supposed to be, I started embracing it a lot more. I think my faith has definitely helped me. It's helped me in every moment of my life in some way, but you recognize it more on this walk, for sure. And I've started to recognize that you receive things every single day. It's not just on this pilgrimage that I recognize times where I've actually received such kindness from people, even before in my former life, you know, and doing this sort of pilgrimage, it gives you a chance, an opportunity to recognize the beautiful things that happen every single day, those small little miracles. And I guess that's what I love about this walk. It gives you the time to reflect and to recognize little pieces of God's grace. And yeah, that's a real blessing and a real beauty of it, I guess.
Patrick continued his trip, reaching the south of Italy and taking a ferry across the Adriatic Sea to Albania. From there, he walked through Macedonia to Greece, where he sprained his back after an accident and later even fought off a pack of stray dogs.
It's like going back in time.
Then it was into Turkey. He arrived safe and sound to Istanbul on November the 7th, and from there, it was on for one last leg of the journey to Jerusalem.